On today's show, we have Nelson Lau, the founder and CEO of PropertyQuants. I'm very excited to have Nelson, actually, because he's an expert in AI and was actually my teacher. I did a course on AI and data science, and that's how I met Nelson. Nelson, how are you doing?
Okay, not too bad. Thanks so much for having me on the show.
You know, it's good to have an AI expert on the show because I feel like there couldn't be any industry more ripe for disruption than the one we're in right now, you know, in real estate and property tech.
Yeah, no, I think that's true. You know, part of the course that you did with us, we talk about sort of the monetization opportunities and what's going on, and we see something in every space, right? From like just selling the data to building the indexes to automated valuation in real estate, forecasting and all of the new stuff too, right? So I think image recognition, chatbots, there's just tons of stuff going on, right?
Yeah, so Nelson, before we dive into all of that, you've got a fascinating background because you actually came from the finance world where there was a lot of focus on quant and trading, and you've gone all the way to PhD level. Why don't you tell us a bit about your journey and how you got here?
Yeah, no, thanks so much. So that's in a nutshell how I got here. Starting from the beginning, so in university, I did economics and math stat. I was always interested in stock trading. And in that era, I was sort of, you know, they had these books about technical analysis of the markets and they show these patterns and stuff. And I was like, is that right? Does this stuff actually work? And there's these two thick books anyway. So then I, by a lot of luck, you know, happened to be at Columbia. I was in New York, so a lot of hedge funds, right? And there was opportunity to do an internship. And I actually, luckily enough, got into a place where they were doing everything in a data science, data-driven way, had this piece of software that would enable you to propose a hypothesis. When X and Y and Z happen, what happens next, right? And so very much was able to apply this sort of data-driven evidence-based way of verifying, hey, you know, is this pattern actually useful? Turns out that most of them don't actually work, but there are a few things that are actually, significant and predictive of the markets. And so that's sort of where I cut my teeth and always have this idea about if we're going to invest, we should be looking at the data and we should be finding reliable signals about what we should be doing next, right? To buy or sell in particular markets. Then along the way, decided to continue my education, got into data science at INSEAD. So, you know, very much how do we take a business problem, make it into a math problem, how do we solve that, and what are people actually doing? And then continued, into sort of asset management outside of sovereign wealth fund, GIC in Singapore, looking at tactical asset allocation for a bit, and then high frequency trading. So again, building these sort of data-driven models to invest. And along the way, was looking at real estate investing. So I was investing for myself in a couple of different places, London and Tokyo and Singapore. And then I was looking around and saying, hey, you know, how are people actually doing this? Right? This seems really different from what we're doing on a day-to-day basis, in the financial world. And we spent some time poking around and saying, hey, you know, maybe we just don't know, right? Maybe people are doing this and we don't know that people are taking really quantitative bet. And after looking for some time, we sort of determined that, hey, there does seem to be a little bit of a gap. The way that we think about it, you know, maybe real estate is a little bit like where we were in finance maybe 20 years ago, when you had these quantitative funds and that was still a new thing. So when I was just starting my career, there were some, right? Obviously you had the Renaissance technologies and the Bridgewater who'd be doing it before then, but it was still a relatively new thing. And then one of the statistics we like to point out is that if we think about it today, you know, one third of every dollar in hedge funds, right, is invested in quantitative hedge funds. And depending on who you ask the statistics from, 60 to 80% of all trades is done by computer algorithms in the stock market, right? So can we bring the same thing into real estate? And that's how we got here. As mentioned, I think a lot of that is beginning to move that way, but we might still be in the early days.
You know, Nelson, it's funny, you just casually say the real estate industry is 20 years behind. And it's crazy, you know, 20 years. Can you imagine if the finance industry were 20 years behind, or if the internet world were 20 years behind, we wouldn't be doing this. I mean, our world changed so much during COVID, and I know property and real estate is changing a lot too, but this is the one thing that shocked me as well. When I came into real estate, I was just horrified at how much reliance there is on spreadsheets, how the industry thrives on information asymmetry, where you're relying on an opinion from a human being and the gut and the instinct. And I think there's a place for gut and instinct, but it's far behind. Infrastructure's lacking.
Yeah, you know, so when I was starting out on the trading desk, they were starting to use FX platforms. So today, most trading on FX is really algorithmic. You go on the platforms or you trade in futures and so on. And it was the beginning of that, right? So you would hit something on what used to be called FXall and you'd get a quote, right? So you didn't 100% know where the market was, but it was already a lot better because you'd get an electronic quote from all these different brokers. You get like a Citi quote, a Goldman quote, and things like that. And you could hit who you want to deal with. And the traders were already telling me that, yeah, you know, this is so much better because like 5-10 years ago, nobody really knew where, like, you know, whatever it was, right? You know, sterling versus USD was. And so, you know, if you call different guys, you might get a spread that was like just way apart and you could take advantage of that, or they could take advantage of you. And think about real estate. It's kind of the way it is today. How much is this building worth? How much should it be trading for? How much did the next door building trade for, right? Things like that still remain opaque, but that's beginning to clear up, right? So we're beginning to see a lot more organization across the world, more companies pulling this data together, trying to aggregate that. So that's why I say maybe we're about 20 years behind in that sense, right?
So, you know, in the finance industry, you talked about, you know, simple examples like the mispricing of assets and how that allows someone to make a quick buck. Is that what's going on in real estate? People are making quick, easy money because of some arbitrage opportunity they've seen and the data isn't there.
I mean, I think there's still a lot of that going on, right? That's why, and this is sort of a broader conversation topic, right? We got into the space saying, hey, you know, we want to take data-driven methods and use that to either make advisory or to invest and so on. And, you know, along the way, you know, we have chatted with some of these larger companies and say, hey, we can help you make sense of this data and figure out certain insights. And they say, okay, this is great. What do you need? And we say, okay, well, you kind of need to share with us the transactions you're seeing or the data sets that you have. And there's an absolute sort of like, you know, caution or apprehension there, because knowing where the price is kind of the alpha for a lot of real estate guys, right? Especially in commercial real estate. So absolutely, I agree with that.
What does that mean? Does that mean that the market's going to see a shift as it did in the fintech or the finance world, where your average consumer now versus institutions are becoming, you know, more and more prevalent? I know there's this seesaw and a fight constantly with the Reddit crowd and, you know, AMC, GME type of stuff happening. But what's going to happen in real estate? Is it going to be that the larger institutions who have data are going to dominate? Or do you think it'll stay the same and it'll be very fragmented?
So I think there's a couple of paths. Obviously, nobody knows for sure. But I think that the data transparency piece is increasing. I think the US is a particularly good place for this. I mean, first and foremost, you know, a lot of the transaction data, especially residential, was recorded or is recorded on the county offices. And then you have all these companies, right? You know, Cherry puts it together, House Canary, Atom Data, a bunch of other people are putting this together. And I think over time, that becomes more and more cost effective to access. And you have a couple of players who might become like the Bloomberg or Thomson Reuters for real estate. And so, you know, one of the things that we're shopping initially is, you know, we still get this question, like, where is the market? Which market has gone up the most? What is the current yield? And we are actually trying to put that together for a couple of markets, you know, that we monitor, and then try to have a dashboard that we can then use and on sell to tell people exactly what's going on. Where do we think the current yield is, net of all of these factors and so on. But the fact that you can't do that versus in finance, this is free, right? On Yahoo Finance or Google Finance, or, you know, if you log into any of your trading apps, right, they'll just show you this stuff, right? So I think that's one path, right? So we go down that way. Another path is that, yeah, you know, there are parts of finance that remain still a little bit more opaque, right? Like, you know, maybe even with the corporate bonds, there is some information, but it is not as clear. It's a little bit fragmented. So maybe we end up a little bit there. But even that is changing a little bit, right? There is a little bit more push for electronic trading of corporate bonds. There is some activity in that space that's making it more open. So let's see. And then in terms of who's doing the trading, some interesting articles recently, right, that some of the iBuyers are stepping in and buying the properties before from the developers before the individuals, right? So maybe that happens, right? They're more informed. So hard to say. The other piece that determines it is, I guess, government regulation, right? So governments typically step in with a lot of legislation around, especially residential real estate. I think that didn't happen so much in finance because sort of, you know, viewed as more open Less legislation is better, right? People, you know, should be knowing what they're doing versus real estate, right?
So, do you see in the market today larger firms building out data science and analysis functions? Are they hiring more? There's an interest right now, and you know, I did your course too, but you know, because I just felt that AI is going to disrupt real estate, probably one of the biggest opportunities ever. Where is the disruption happening? Are large firms hiring, or is it more just individual startups and the large firms are, you know, going to be disrupted because they're not embracing AI?
So I think both. So absolutely right. There is a lot of interest. One of the things that we often point out is, you know, as we talk with people, is we looked at those KPMG PropTech surveys, 2018, 2019. And like, yeah, half of real estate participants said that of all the technologies out there, you have like, you know, this data science AI, you have VR, AR, you have tons of stuff, right? But half of them said that it's going to be this data science AI, big data, that's going to have the biggest impact on the real estate industry. And that survey also showed that, you know, there's still 80% of companies who have a ways to go in terms of harnessing data-driven decision-making, and that there's also a skills gap, right? They were also saying that of all the people leading data science or digital transformation efforts in real estate companies, only 5% of people have the right sort of background for that. But what are we seeing, right? So we saw people coming in, we run this course on teaching data science machine learning for real estate, and we're increasingly seeing more and more, you know, there are some large companies who do send analysts and researchers to the course. There are some medium sort of, especially investment funds, will say, hey, you know, we want to use these methods. Can we send a couple of analysts for this? And then, yes, there are startups in the space who are doing that as well.
Wait, what did you say 5% of people in these roles aren't only qualified and 95% aren't for the role?
I mean, that's what the survey suggests. So I think it's the KPMG PropTech Survey 2019 is saying of the people leading a digital transformation effort in real estate companies, only 5% have a background in data analytics, and the others are all sorts of other things, right?
You know, I'm obviously, many of the people listening to this podcast are trying to figure out the digital transformation. And the first thing you do, you're in real estate and you realize the industry is being disrupted. You get excited about the idea of prop tech and you figure out how you can implement it. And, you know, either you use it as a vendor and you bring in a product or service and you pay for it, or you go hire and you build internal competency. So talk us through, what advice do you have for folks at large companies? How do they lead the digital transformation? And specifically, how should they think about AI? What do they need to have in place before AI even makes sense? And any practical advice for these types of people?
Yeah, look, I mean, I think it, first and foremost, you know, it depends on what you're doing. So some large companies will be generating data that's really useful, right? If you are a brokerage firm, you're going to be generating tons of data that you could use internally about where various markets are at, operating costs of various buildings, all of these things that could create insights that will be unique to you or to help your clients. And first thing first, you know, how is that being recorded, right? So oftentimes you have a lot of these, maybe you think about leases, right? Just commercial leases tend to be these, like, you know, very long PDF documents. And that's not really easily usable in terms of doing some kind of analysis. There are companies that are springing up in this space, right? So we were in the Colliers TechStars program a couple of years back, together with some companies in that space, right? So like AdX does that, they'll help you to make that into a digital record. And so, you know, taking some steps to actually have all of that information that you already own be in a format that's usable to do analysis, right? The next thing is sort of, you know, sharing of data, right? So in a large company, right, there may be silos or there may be a lot of organic acquisitions. You know, how do we make sure that various teams in the firm are willing and able to share? Because there is this sense that, you know, maybe, and it depends again on the setup, but like my commissions, right, are kind of what is important. Why should I share this with somebody else, right? And so that becomes a little bit of a problem. So creating the culture where understanding that, you know, sort of sharing the data creates sort of a better potential for all of us together, I think that's also useful. And then, you know, the next step then is, what do you want to do? Do you want to, as you mentioned, build out your own team, or do you want to engage sort of outsiders to do that? You know, a lot of times what we're seeing is that people might come and they might ask, okay, we want to build out some kind of analysis of this. If I use an external company, well, what do they need? And the company would say, okay, we need to work on the data, which means you need to share with us. And there's a lot of apprehension about that. I actually think there doesn't need to be. I think, you can contract and, a lot of companies are not interested in sort of stealing your data, but to actually help you to do that. So a little bit more openness on that front. But if, to the extent that if that's insurmountable, then you want to go down this route of building it out yourself, hire out your own team, you can do that. But then the next thing is, who do you hire? How do you figure that out? So, our course is helpful a little bit, right? We're going to tell you a little bit about the various things you might want to do. You can go a little bit in depth on that. And then the last note, people say, hey, I want to get into data science. One of the common pitfalls is then, okay, I'm going to go hire like a PhD researcher in data science. Well, that's maybe not the right guy because he's going to want to build like new algorithms and figure out, new kind of intellectual things and new models. And maybe what you want is somebody who understands that, right, and is sort of interested in applying it and seeing it take, and make an impact in the actual world, right?